Today is January 15, 1998. My name is Helen Sendick, H-E-L-E-N-S-E-N-D-Y-K. I am interviewing Edith Milman, E-D-I-T-H-M-I-L-M-A-N, in Deerfield Beach, Florida, and the language is English.
Today is January 15th, 1998. My name is Helen Sendick, H-E-L-E-N-S-E-N-D-Y-K. I am interviewing Edith Milman, E-D-I-T-H-M-I-L-M-A-N, in Deerfield Beach, Florida, and the language is English. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Tell me, please, your name.
My name is Edith Milman, E-D-I-T-H-M-I-L-M-A-N.
And what is your date of birth?
I was born June 23rd, 1926.
How old are you?
I'm 71 years old.
Where were you born?
I was born in Nowy Sącz, Poland. N-O-W-Y. S-A-C-Z.
What was the name of your mother?
My mother's name was Anna, A-N-N-A.
Do you remember your mother's parents, your grandparents?
I remember them well. They were with us all through the war.
Tell me, please, the name of your grandmother and what you remember about her.
My grandmother on my mother's side,
yes,
was Dora, D-O-R-A, Frey, F-R-E-Y.
Tell me what you remember about her when you still lived in Nowy Sącz.
Grandmother Fry did not live in Nowy Sącz. They lived in a small village where my grandfather was a director of a tartak. I don't know the English
it's
name.
A mill.
For. A mill? A mill. He was a director of it, and they lived in Olszanice, was a small village in East Poland, southeast Poland. And we used to go there very often for vacation because it was a perfect vacation spot for us. And over there we met with the family of my mother's sister, her husband, and the children who lived very close by. Grandmother stayed with us all through the war and came with us to the United States and passed away in the States in 1957.
Tell me the name of your grandfather, your maternal grandfather.
His first name was Rudolf, R-U-D-O-L-F, Frey, F-R-E-Y. He was a wonderful, wonderful man, very family oriented, and as I mentioned before, he was a director of a mill and until his retirement, and he retired sometimes around 35, maybe 36, and moved to Sanok. He also traveled with us all through the war and died in Russia during the epidemic of typhoid.
But tell me about the times when you visited your grandparents.
That was wonderful times. We had a wonderful time together. The country, the surroundings, all the things we as kids could do. The place was very attractive for us. Picture a mill with all the stacked woods over there, hiding places was the most enjoyable time of our life. You could hide forever, never be found. And we had three children in my family, and my aunt had three children. Between the six of us, we had a ball. And we went there almost every summer. It's wonderful days.
Now, what about your paternal grandparents?
My father's father, Abraham Birnbaum, A-B-R-A-A-H-A-M, died in 1920, so I did not know him at all. My grandmother, Hinda, H-I-N-D-A, Birnbaum, lived in the same house we did, actually in the same building. We had a two-family house. We lived in one part of the house I lived with my parents, my brother Alfred, and my sister Ada. And my grandmother lived on the other side of the house with her widowed daughter-in-law. Her name was Ruchcha, R-O-C-H-I-A, Birnbaum, B-I-R-N-B-A-U-M. My grandmother was extremely religious, very, very Orthodox lady who devoted her life to religion. And she used to do the cooking for the family when we lived in Novosonj. We had a maid who lived with us, but she was not cooking because she was not Jewish, so my grandmother did all the cooking. We ate in her house, but we lived separately. It was a real Jewish, well-off home where a next-door rabbi would come and read the Megillah for Purim, and that kind of a very, very Orthodox home. That was my grandmother's, not ours. We were very progressive.
Tell me about your mother.
My mother, Anna, A-N-N-A, Frey, F-R-E-Y, was a far second or third cousin of my father. They were related some far behind. And she was one of the very few women who were far ahead of her generation. She, as I mentioned before, her parents lived in a small village. That's what the mills were. So she was sent to Krakow to her grandparents to go to school. She was the oldest daughter out of four children. She attended the schools in Krakow, living with her grandparents. When the war started, the First World War, they fled to Vienna, and in Vienna my mother went to the University of Vienna and graduated as a pharmacist in 1920. In Vienna she still lived with her grandparents, although her parents lived in the same building in Vienna, but she was used to living with her grandparents from age of 10. And in Vienna, she met my father, and they got married in Vienna in 1920. They stayed there till 1921. My brother Alfred was born there, and sometimes after that, they moved back to Novosonj, where my father had his business.
Tell me about your father.
My father was...
Tell me his name first.
His name was Joseph, J-O-S-E-P-H, and he was very worldly person, a person who learned everything he could. He was very, very socially active. He loved everything that life gave, dancing, cards playing, traveling. That was his day. He was a businessman. He had, if there was a family business, they were exporters of eggs to Western Europe. It was an excellent business. In the house we lived, the basement was full of basins that the eggs were kept in. They used to pick them up at the market. and sell them to Western Europe. That business came to a close when Hitler came, and in 1934, he no longer permitted any imports. He had to save the money for the destruction of the world. So nothing was being imported, and that was a great part. So he had to, the business went down, and then he switched to another business, and he was traveling constantly between Poland and London. That's what the business connections were, and he had three brothers there. And he went into a business of import of casings for salamis and all that stuff. Now we use plastics for Frankfurters. Now we use plastic. At that time, they used the intestine of sheep, basically. And this was imported from Far East, from Asia, and brought and sold all over Europe. And that's what my father was doing. He never sold the product for all practical purposes. He was just dealing with buying and selling without almost ever seeing what is it all about. It was a good business.
What about the house you lived in? Did you own that house, or was it a rented house?
In Novi Sad, we owned the house, and this was a big property. A property with a double house that we lived in a big backyard, because with stables, we had horses. And there was a little house there in which my great-grandfather lived, my paternal grandmother's father. He was a very, very old man. I hardly remember him ever going out of there. Then we had a big, tremendous garden, fruit garden. So it was a big, big property, and we owned it. When we moved out in 1937 to Krakow, we rented a place. We rented an apartment in one of the newest, most luxurious buildings. We had four-room apartment plus maid quarters. The maid had her own room just off the kitchen, and then we had a living room, a dining room, and a bedroom. And in each of the other rooms, there used to be day beds that used to serve as the sleeping quarters for my sister and myself. My brother did not live with us because he remained in Novi Sad since he was going to gymnasium, equivalent to our high school, and he wanted to finish there. It was not that easy to transfer for a Jewish fellow to be admitted to a public gymnasium was a problem by itself. So he did not move with us. So there were the four of us plus the maid living in Krakow.
When did you move to Krakow?
In 1937.
Where did you go to school?
In Novi Sad, I went to a private Hebrew school, Tarbut schools. They used to be Zionist schools with the main language Hebrew. And the school was growing with me, because when I started in first grade, there were only two grades. And then every year, a grade was added. So I got a chance to go there until the sixth grade, and then moved to Krakow and went to the Hebrew gymnasium, also a private school, but no more Tarbut. The language was Polish, only with some Hebrew in it. And I was in it until the war started. And after that, there were already occasional schoolings. On and off.
Describe to me the life of your family in Novi Sad. Did you observe holidays?
We were. I was born into quite comfortable family, and very traditional. As I mentioned before, my grandmother was very Orthodox, but it was not the case with us. We lived in very close to each other, but we did not observe the same traditions. We all holidays were very strictly observed with great emphasis on it. My grandmother had a little shtiebel, which was small praying quarters in the name of my grandfather that was ultra-Orthodox, and that's where she used to go. And my father was supposed to go, but that wasn't always the case. He didn't believe in it too much. My mother was much more progressive, and she attended a temple. A temple in Poland was equivalent to a conservative synagogue here, although still the women and men were separated, but they were cantors, and it was a completely different atmosphere than it was in the little shtiebel. All the holidays were strictly observed. It was a very happy family. As I mentioned, all of us were pushed to schools. We never worked. Nobody worked. Except for father, nobody worked. My mother never worked. She was very busy in social causes. She was very active in the orphanage, Jewish orphanage. We had a very large Jewish orphanage. She was very active in school. She was very active in Wieso. She used to go dancing with my father almost quite often, but she never played cards. So her time was devoted to social work. Very active, very active.
How big a town was Nowy Sącz?
I don't know, maybe 50,000 people. With a great, great Jewish population. Quite large. I really don't know. That number is just taken out of my head. I don't know. At that time, I guess the numbers didn't mean anything, so I really don't know.
Who were your friends?
I was surrounded by friends, school friends. I went to school, to the Tarbut school, and we were very fortunate because although it was a private school, it did not consist of only the chosen wealthy children of Nowy Sącz. We had half of it, at least, were children whose tuition were subsidized, who came from the orphanage or from the poor families. And just to mention the fact that due to the fact that was such a great discrepancy between the families' incomes, and my mother instituted a school program for lunches, that all the children got the same lunch. It consisted of roll with some butter on it and a container of chocolate milk or a fruit, because at the beginning there were kids who were coming with bananas. That was very rare and very expensive fruit, and the kids from orphanage came with dry bread. So to eliminate the classes differences, she was, as I mentioned, she was very socially minded. That was what she did. And so my friends were mostly school friends. I had no children. There was no other member of the family living in Nowy Sącz where we lived.
Did you have any contact with non-Jews?
Very little. I would say none for all practical purposes. Except once in a while we would have guests of my parents that were non-Jews. As I said, father was very active in the social circles. So we had quite few friends who were non-Jewish, but none of the children, we did not associate with them at all.
So how would you describe the relationship between your parents and their non-Jewish friends?
They were fine between them. But the children of their friends, they were not so good. They were just as anti-Semitic as they come, and we had one experience with it, so I know that that was the case.
Tell me about that experience.
It was, we were staying in Zakopane in a house of one of their friends. He was a director of a bank and had a villa in Zakopane. And we were staying there, and his son, who was at that time 15 or 16, and I must have been 8 or 9, shot himself accidentally in his foot playing with a revolver. And we were staying on the second floor, and he was on the first floor. And as they were carrying him out on a stretcher, we kids curious to see what's going on. It was a big excitement in the house. A rescue squad came and a stretcher. We were looking, and all he did, he looked up and cursed us, the kid, while being carried out, cursed us that we were standing upstairs looking as Jews. This was the son of a very good friend of ours, because as I mentioned, we lived in the same house. We stayed in their house during vacation time. But the kids did not have the same feeling.
What were these curses? What did he curse?
Dirty Jew. All kind of cholera, you know, all kind of diseases that were used as curses. This I never forgot. As I said, the children did not have the same feeling as their parents did. And after the war, that particular guy survived and came asking for help from us. You forgot already.
You said you had a sister and a brother.
Right.
Tell me about your sister and brother.
I have a brother who is 5 years older than myself. His name is Alfred, A-L-F-E-R-E-D, Alfred. And I have a sister who is 3 years younger than myself. Her name is Ada, A-D-A. She is now, her married name is Urbach, U-R-B-A-C-H. Now, there was a big age difference. 5 years at that time was a tremendous age difference. So my brother was very often on his own, and me and my sister were together with parents most of the time. He was going to school, graduated in 1939, graduated Lyceum, which was the second part of high school, the last 2 years of high school, and was accepted to University of Oxford in England, because there was no chance for a Jewish student to attend a Polish university. He got the permission to delay his army recruiting, because in Poland they recruited to the army at the age of 18. He got a postponement, and he was supposed to go to England to study, which never came into being because the war started. Let's go back to my sister. My sister was a little girl. She was 3 years younger than myself. She attended public school. She attended public school in Krakow, until also Hebrew public school, until the war started. And then we were never separated during the war. We were all together until today.
Now, you said you moved to Krakow. Was there any reason why you moved to Krakow?
My father's business was better. It was a better location for him to be. Mm-hmm. It was easier for him to deal there.
Do you remember the move?
Yes. I remember the apartment. It was unbelievable luxury, something that I have not experienced before, because Novosibirsk did not have, for instance, did not have sewer system yet at that time. And here we moved to a building that had an elevator, had bathroom, had hot water, had gas refrigerator, something that, I mean, we talk about it today, it doesn't amount to anything, but going back to 38 or 37, when it was totally unknown, was a great thing. Great. Great thing.
So you said you continued school in Krakow.
Right.
And who were your friends then?
also my school friends. A couple of them are alive and here in America. I met with them not long ago. I'm meeting with one most of the time. But I don't remember too much. I really don't.
Did your grandmother, did she move with you to Krakow?
No. My grandmother and my aunt remained in the same house they lived.
But did you still have contact with them?
Constant contact. My brother still lived in the house where my grandmother did, in our house, in our part of the house. He stayed behind.
How was your life then in Krakow without your grandmother? You said that your grandmother cooked for the family. How did that change in Krakow?
That was very easy. We had a maid. We had the same maid. We had the same maid from as long as I remember. A beautiful girl who came to the family when she was 16. It was customary. The people used to send, they had a daughter, they used to send her away, so because they couldn't afford to feed her, the very poor families of farmers. And so she was with us since she was six, from age of 16. And she cooked. She cooked and she took care of the household. My mother never cooked. My mother did not know how to cook.
But did your mother continue her social activities in Krakow?
Yes, she did. She continued and she had she was involved with, as I said, quite few, even I think some kind of outside of VIZ or some other organization, I don't know. But as I said, she was all social work. And there was a family already. Mother had a large family in Krakow, and she was raised in Krakow, so that was really her hometown. So she was very happy there. It was a big town with much more exposure to culture and all kind of activities that were not available in Nova Scotia.
We have to stop for the changing of the tape.
Okay.
Your father, you said, was now in a second type of business, in a second endeavor, importing. This is tape number 2 of Edith Milman. I'm sorry. And we stopped when you said that your father was now in a different kind of business. He had to give up the egg business and was now an import of the implements for sausages.
Yeah, the casings.
The casings for sausages. He conducted that business in Krakow?
Yes, he continued.
Continued to conduct this business in Krakow. Right. Did he have any specific place that he went to work, or he conducted it from his house?
No, it was all paperwork. Telephone calls, paperwork. We didn't have any office at home, and I really don't know exact details how it was done, because I don't remember ever seeing anybody doing anything. As far as I was concerned, father was doing nothing. But money was coming in, I guess, and we lived quite comfortably, so I couldn't care less.
How was your relationship with your father?
Very good. Very good till the day he died. Very good.
And
I happened to be his favorite daughter. My sister was my mother's favorite daughter, and I was my father's favorite daughter. So we even discussed.
How did this favoritism express itself?
I don't know. You just felt it. I don't know. You just felt.
Did you get gifts?
No. There was never any differential treatment for any of the children from either parents. Never. I never felt that anybody was more privileged than the other, although I was a middle child, as they say, everybody was complaining about the middle child. I don't think I have ever any problem with in my family surroundings, never. I didn't feel it.
How was your religious life? Was it different than a novice aunt?
It was not any different because we did in novice aunt the same thing we did in Krakow, not exactly anything that agreed with my grandmother, except here we didn't have to hide it. If we wanted to get a non-kosher food at home, it was always served there. In grandmother's house, we had to hide it. But otherwise, I said my parents were very progressive. My mother was much greater believer than my father was. But so she continued attending temple and high holidays, a lot of the high holidays we used to go back to grandmother in Nowy Sącz because she was alone. And we continued the same way. Our religions did not change at all because we didn't practice it in Nowy Sącz anyhow.
What about the social life? Did the social life change any?
No.
The friends, the neighbors?
The friends changed because the cities changed, but as I said, my mother felt very happy in Krakow. It was her hometown. And she had family there. She had an uncle there, an aunt. She had a couple aunts, a couple uncles, cousins that lived in Krakow permanently.
What were your leisure activities after school?
Playing. Winter time, we used to go skiing, favorite, and sled riding was winter time. Summers we spent always outside of our hometowns, either at my grandparents or going to one of the resort places in the mountains every summer. So there was swimming and bicycling and ball playing and things. We did not take part in any activity, you know, like organized sports, but I didn't know if they were any, so I am not aware of it. Belonged to a club in school.
What kind of club?
It was a Zionist club, so I don't remember the name of it. I even went to a camp with them just before the war, the last summer, and we had difficulty getting back home because the rumors of war starting were coming in and all the train coming from the place we were to Krakow were full. And finally, out of desperation, they put us in a train going in the opposite direction, going to Zakopane because that train was empty. So we went to Zakopane, stayed on the same train, and went back to Krakow. And I arrived in Krakow 2 days, 3 days before the war started. From a summer camp. Don't remember the name of it.
And what happened then?
We lived in Krakow just across the street from a railroad station. It was a known fact that if the war will start and the rumors were all there, the first thing they're going to bomb is a railroad station because that was the only way of communication. So we didn't have that many cars traveling around. So that was a known fact. And the day on September 30th, in the afternoon, my father,
September
30th, 1939. August 30th, 1939. My father took his cousin and her little girl who were Jews who were sent out of Germany in 1937, I think, or 38, I don't remember. They got all the East Jews out of Germany and sent them to Poland. Among them was this cousin and her little girl, whose husband has left already Poland and went to Israel about a couple months before that.
Do you remember their names? That's okay.
I don't. This
no, that's okay.
Second, I will.
Okay.
Felber. Felber was the name. And my father took that woman, Mira Felber, and her daughter Sylvia, who lives here now, and put them on a train to go to the Romanian border. He says, you have nothing to do here. Try to go to the Romanian border, cross the border, and that's your only chance to join your husband if something happens, which he did. And look, when he came back from the station, it was only less than half a block away to our house. He came home and he says, we are leaving. There is still a chance to get out by train. We are leaving. We're not going to wait here until the war, until the bombs will fall. So each of us packed a little valise and out we went. And we boarded a train for Przemyśl, I don't know how to spell it.
That's okay.
And by the time we boarded the train, it was about 10, 11 o'clock at night. The trains were full. It was almost impossible to get into it. And my father, my mother, my sister, myself, and the maid went to Przemyśl.
The maid went with you?
The maid went with us.
What did you take along? In
we valise? Took along each one a minimum of a valise of clothing. Small valise of clothes we had, and pictures. Family pictures always went along. My father, as I hear from recollection of my sister, went to the bank and got some money out, not all of it. And what I understand, and I don't remember what they do, he tried to get into the safe and got some stuff out of the safe, but could not get all of it, and as long as he had some money and some jewelry with us, we took off. And we arrived in Przemyśl the following day, and then my father had a very good friend of theirs who lived in Nowy Sącz and asked him to bring his mother over to Przemyśl with him. He was a divorced man with a child, and my parents were like surrogate parents to this boy. And so they were always with us. It was we called him an uncle, although he was not. And he wanted to bring my grandmother, my father's mother, over to Przemyśl, and she refused to go, saying that she saw that it's very good here, and the people had no problem with the First World War, and she's not going. So he came, that friend of ours, by the name of Hugo Sternlich, and his son Benno, and my brother came to Przemyśl. Also my mother's parents came to Przemyśl, and my mother's sister, her brother-in-law, and three children, the family of Manya and Józef Manaster, M-A-N-A-S-T-E-R, all arrived in Przemyśl. Now we were as many of our family as we could, we were right there.
Where did you go in Przemyśl?
We stayed in the hotel. We arrived at the hotel early in the morning on August 31st. And September 1st, the war started. And we were there only for a couple days because, as I said, my father was a very quick thinker. He was very good at it. He said, that's not the place to be. Przemyśl is a big city. We don't want to be here. So together, there was already a family. We were a group. There were five of us and five my aunt. It was 10. The maid was 11. My grandparents were 13, Hugo Stendig and his son were 15 people. We had a whole big group already. They rented a bus. We all went on a bus and started going east, away. We reached a small place by the name of Sokol, and I don't know, it's east of Przemysl, but I don't know exact location. Over there, they did not even know what war is. I don't, they might have been a radio in the town or not, I'm not sure, little town. And so we decided, oh, that's a terrific place to stay. We're going to wait the war through right here. We're going to sit it out. And when we occupied the only three hotels they were in town, that was one building that was divided in three parts. Downstairs there was a restaurant, there was a drugstore, and I don't remember the other store. And upstairs they were rooms, hotel rooms. It was just enough for us to take up the whole spot. I don't recall exactly whether my mother's brother was with us. I don't think so. I'm not sure. And we stayed there. We gave up the bus because it was at that point there was no, you couldn't get any fuel anymore. So that was a useless thing. And we thought that that's our heaven. We're going to stay there forever. The restaurant would come in the morning, the chef would come in and ask what we want for dinner. And it was only people, strangers in town. It was a great deal. But they didn't last too long. The Germans started moving. The war was in full force. They were already past Krakow in the first few days. And we went, continue on. This time they bought two hay wagons and four horses. We loaded the whole caboodle on top of them and we were going. And we were traveling east towards the Russian border, figuring that if the Germans will come in, we will get a chance to cross the border and be on the safe side. We reached the Russian border on the 16th of September.
1939,
stayed with a family of local people, and on the next morning, early in the morning, the Russians crossed into Poland. They were there. The people no longer wanted to give us anything. That was one of the poorest sections of Poland, and they thought that Messiah has come, the Russians are here, we'll take all the wealth from the wealthy people and we'll be wealthy now. So they did not want to offer us not a glass of water. We got back on our hay wagons and our horses and started back, followed just in back of the Russian invasion army.
To who did those horses and wagons belong?
Us. We bought them.
Oh, you bought them?
Yes, we bought them.
And who rode them? Who?
Oh, that was easy. My father one and my uncle another one. We had two of them, two wagons. And we would alternate, you know, kids would go here, kids would go there.
Did nobody checked you or stopped you?
No. That was nothing there. There was no activities yet. And as the Russians were walking in, I don't think they cared. They did not know what's going on. As I said, we went just behind them, almost directly behind the invading armies. They didn't care.
So, but you said you were fleeing from the Germans to the Russians.
The Russians came to us. They invaded Poland.
So you reversed your
directions?
Right. Going behind the Russians?
That's right. Going back, following the Russians, going back into Poland. We came to a town of Równo that we stayed there for a little while and didn't care for it. And then we rented one of the cars, the railroad cars, because we were already, there was my uncle and my aunt were also with me. And my mother's brother, Bronisław, and his new wife, Inga. They were also with us. So we got the car, they rented the railroad car and attached it to a train that went to Lviv.
Why did you reverse that?
Because we did not want to go to Russia. We just were running away from the Germans. So when the Russians were occupied Poland, we assumed that that pact, whatever they made, we found out later what it was, it's there to stay. We thought that the Russian world would remain in Poland until the war will be over. But it was not the case, as we found out a little bit later. So we arrived, all of us came to Lviv. We did not stay in Rovno. It was not no life for us. We had to go to schools, you know, we had to do things, although Rovno had it, but it was very depressing, and we didn't like it at all. It was pre-war, very communist, pre-war, and they thought that, again, that was their, you know, that was, they were liberated. It was not our idea. We were always anti-communist, so we never liked the political ideas of that deal. So that's how we came to Lviv.
When did you arrive in
Lviv? We arrived in Lviv, I would say sometimes October, November of 1939. And I enrolled again in school. I went to high school. I started for a very short time in the Hebrew high school that no longer was Hebrew. It was called Jewish Gymnasium. And they turned from being a Zionist to communists and did not go well with me. So I dropped it out after a very short while and moved to a Polish gymnasium that was the Sacra Cur Gymnasium in Poland, attending the second grade of the gymnasium. My sister, I think, went to public school, and my brother went nowhere. He already graduated.
Where did you live in Lviv?
We had a very large apartment, and we lived over there, my entire family, my uncle and aunt and their three children, the Manasters, my grandmother, my grandfather, Dora and Rudolf Fry, and on the second floor of the same building, my mother's brother and his wife, Bronisław Broniu and Inga Fry. And there where we stayed. And the situation has changed a little bit because there was a tremendous shortage of food in that time of the time. My mother went to work. And my mother went to work in a pharmacy for the first time in her life. And this enabled her to get us to eat in a, they used to have special kitchens for workers, restaurants that were open to workers. So we could go have our main meals over there. And she got a lot of things. Because it was, you know, there was, a, you know, you give me some headache pills and I give you some chocolate. And that's how it works. So that was a great thing. And my father had a lot of his customers to whom he used to deliver the casings in that part of Poland. And they had no money to pay him, so they gave him products. So we had a lot of salamis and things like this. And just recently, I didn't remember that, but my brother told me that they opened a little booth-like and they were selling, my father and my brother were selling hot sausage and sauerkraut with a piece of bread and making some extra money. And my father was getting the things free because they owed him money and they couldn't pay and they did not know that they would never have to pay, but so that was the way we made some extra money. They did. I didn't go. I went to school.
Did you make any contacts with local people in Lviv?
Some, yes.
Except your family.
Yes, we did some, and I had some friends. I had a very good friend of mine who's now in Israel, still lives, whose family came from Lviv, and she was there. We went to school together. We had some friends that we made there right away. School friends you make right away, 1 to 3. But it was limited because we were not dead long enough. See, it was all over by on June 29th, middle of the night.
June 29th of what?
June 29, 1940. I have to back off a little bit. Few months before that, the Russians asked everybody to take out Russian citizenship papers to become Russian citizens. Now, my father said, no, never, never, I will become a Russian citizen. So we remained living in Poland without having the citizenships. And at that time, we knew already that something will happen. We did not know what. So my parents sent the maid away. They said she came from the part of Poland that was occupied by the Russian. So they decided let her go home and stay with her family and we'll be okay. So we stayed alone. Mother didn't cook. I did not know how. I tried, but didn't work. So as I said, we ate in the restaurant for the employees, which was okay. And on June 29th, middle of the night, they came in NKVD, and all they were asked, do you have a Russian passport? And if you didn't have it, they loaded us into cars or trucks, I don't recall. They told us you can take anything you want with you, give you enough time to pack up whatever you have, and come with us. My uncle, my mother's brother, whose wife was born in Lviv and automatically was a citizen of Lviv, she had the citizen's paper and they let him stay because he was married to a citizen, Russian citizen, so he remained. The rest of us, my grandparents, our family, and my aunt's family were all taken by trucks to the railroad, whatever it was parked. It was not parked at the station, railroad tracks. And they loaded us into a cattle cars with whatever we had. We had whatever.
What were you able to take?
Everything. Whatever we had, they accumulated already, you know. You had some towels and some covers and bedspreads and pillows and blankets and clothing, you know, we were already settled. And all this we could pack. We could take everything we had. There was no limitation. They let us take everything we had in the apartment.
What about furnishings?
No furniture, no. Just the things you could carry or load on a truck. And we were on that, in this pack, you know, in that cattle cars, just us. In the meantime, the friend of ours, Hugo Sternlich and his son, they got visas from the NKVD to leave Lviv on the condition that he will become a spy for them, and he agreed, and he was sent out. He got a visa, exit visa from Russia, went to Iran, at that time Persia, and threw away the shoes with the documents that they put in it, you know, whatever, and never reported to be a spy. But he was out of the country already. And my father, who had a consular Polish passport in England. It means she could travel freely between Poland and England with all the transit visas without asking for them. And in Europe, if you had to leave one country to another, you had to apply for a visa, passport, etc. He had a free way of going, and the NKVD respected it. And they told him, if anything happens to you, you just show them the piece of paper from us and they will let you out and you can come to the NKVD and we will help you out. But when father saw that all of us are together, the whole family, he says, I'm not going anywhere. I'm just staying. Wherever they will take us, they take us together. Because he was afraid if he will leave, that might do something for him but will not do anything for us. So he didn't want to take the chance. So he remained with us. But my uncle, Manaster, was so fearful of going to Russia that he managed to smuggle out of the car his wife, his three sons, and himself without anything on them, just what they were wearing. And they left, and they left and remained in Lvov, unfortunately, because she was killed in a concentration camp, my aunt, and their youngest son died within a year, and the other two sons and their father did survive, but they survived in underground. So they had a very tough time. But we were in the car with my grandparents, and we were shipped to Ural.
So now you are just your own family with your grandparents.
Yes.
We have to stop for changing of the tape.
Okay.
Tape number 3 of Edith Milman. We stopped when you were in the cattle cars in Lvov with your family. Please continue from there.
I do not recall how long the trip took, but we ended up in what Poshovik Teshma, and Poshovik is a very unique, I think it's only Russian could invent it. It's a piece of land that the prisoners, Russian prisoners, cut out in the middle of woods and put a few little houses or whatever where they lived. And after they are released from this prison, another group comes in. And the other group was us. We came to this Poshovik Teshma, which was in Ural, and the only thing I remember was Sverdlovskaya Oblast. That the location of the thing. Over there, we were giving a place to live. It was very primitive, but it was a little house, our family and my grandparents together. And we were considered, I don't know what we were considered, prisoners or not, because there was no way of getting out of there. It was under the management of NKVD. And there was no way you could get out of there. There were no barbed wires, but there was no way of out. There were no roads out, there was nothing. So there we stayed, and everybody had to go to work of age who was. And since I had an elder grandparents, the choice was of my mother going to work. One person could not go. So I was then already 14 years old, and I decided that I will go to work instead of mother, because they're not going to treat me as bad as they could treat my mother, since I was still a child. So I went to work digging potatoes in the field. My father decided that he's also going to do some great thing, business type things. So he, all of a sudden, he became a builder of ovens. He built ovens, you know. So it was good because it was a needed commodity. You know, they used to build oven in each of the little houses, and wood was, you could get all the wood you wanted. So this is what kept us warm.
So was he building these ovens for his own profit?
No.
Or
no.
Doing that as labor?
As labor. We nobody got paid anything. The only thing we got was some food and whatever you could get on your own, like collecting berries. Was a great source of food, berries in the woods. You collect it and they froze. We had cranberries there that would freeze. You would put them in barrel outside and you had them for half of the year until the new one came, because they were frozen there 3/4 of the time. It was very, very cold. Very, very cold. Had a little they had a little hospital. We had a doctor. One of our refugees, you know, one of our people was a physician over there.
How many people were in this camp?
Maybe a thousand.
Were they all Jews?
All Jews.
Were they all Jews from Poland?
They were all Polish Jews, and they were all Jews from the part of Poland that was not occupied by Russia. It means they were all from the part of Poland that was now occupied by Germany, because they were the people who were not Russian citizens. So they were all Polish Jews from Western Poland. So my father started doing that. My brother.
Was it his choice to do that as work?
Or? He managed to get onto it, because other labor was much worse. My brother was sent to, they used to cut down woods, big trees, and throw them into the water that used to create barges. It weren't barges, but that's how the wood was sent down to the places they needed it. Because here it was, and they were cutting it for board someplace, God knows where, someplace south, and the only way it could get out of there was by water, and that was a very hard work. And my father was lucky building the ovens until he got into the disgrace of the manager or whoever he was, Pretsoditel, a Russian, who thought that he didn't like him for his political views or whatever, and especially didn't like him for his association with the physician over there, who was a very good friend of ours, who was put to jail for being anti-communist. So my father was sent to work also in the woods together with my brother, except that my brother was the manager of it, and my father had to do the labor work, and that's where they were, deep into the woods, middle of the night, when I ran to them to tell them that we are free.
But before we go to that,
yeah.
Your mother, you said, did not have to go to work?
No.
And your grandparents did not have
no.
to go to work?
They
what
were
about
too old.
Your sister?
My sister was little.
So
my
she didn't have to
no.
go to work?
I don't know if she was, they were tutoring or not. There was no real school there. I don't remember that. My brother went, my
so
father and I.
Were working.
Right.
And you were supplying the family, so to say?
That we didn't get paid.
What about the food?
They used to give it to us. They used to have a store that would give rations, food ration, so much per person.
Was there any difference between people that worked and people that didn't work as far as rations of food are concerned?
I don't recall, but the working was not by choice. You had to work. And the people who did not work because in their program, these were not the people who were working. They did not want to deal with old people working or with children. So they did not work, not by choice. They did not work because
they were
told not to work.
Did anybody guard you while you were working?
No. There was guard. There was a Pretzel detail, which was like a chairman or whatever who was. There was a group of Russian dignitaries or Russian supervisors on premises. There was a large group of it, but a personal that somebody would stand over us, no.
And not within the camp confines?
Yeah, they were all around there. because there couldn't be any place else. When they were not there, there were not any place close. There was nothing around. Nothing.
So they lived also.
Absolutely.
On they the lived same right premises.
Better surroundings, you know, than we did. But
how was still the relationship between these leading people, these Russian leading people, and the population of prisoners?
They treated us like such. There was no equality. Never mind the equality of Russia. There's no equality. None. None whatsoever. We were prisoners, and they were the guards or management or whatever the name was at that time. I don't recall. Mm-hmm. So they were doing their job, and we had to do ours. Mm-hmm. But we managed. In all these bad things that happened, there's always, you know, silver lining. It was not that bad. I don't recall.
You said there was a little hospital on the premises?
Yes, there was medical care. There was medical care.
Do you know of anybody who was sick? Anybody close?
I don't recall. But as I said, we had a very good friend that we got acquainted in the cattle car going out to Russia, who was a physician. And we stayed with him and remained very, very friendly all through the rest of the war until we came back to Poland.
So now you said that you were freed, right? What?
Yeah, what was free?
You told me a specific date.
Yeah, it was in 1943 or 42, I don't, 42 I think. The Russian had made an agreement with the Polish government in exile in England, and this gave us the right to be, quote, so-called free people. And at that time they started organizing an army, the very well-known army Andersa, that never included Jews except officers. You could not get into the army Andersa if you were Jewish. Antisemitism did not stop, did not diminish. A lot of Polacks already were also sent out by the Russian, imprisoned, etc., etc. But they organized the army, and it was for non-Jews exclusively. I know we had a friend, he was a physician. He was admitted to the army because he was a captain, and he never made it. He died just before they left, but his family went to Israel. And we were free. What does it mean? We could leave the compounds of the Poshevik. You were never free in Russia because you could never travel free. You needed a certificate or right to travel between one town and another. So I don't know if it was before the war like this or during the war. I do not know. But during the war, I know that was the case. So again, we went into the wagons, and we were going south. The whole idea was get out of the heavy winters. We couldn't take it anymore. So we're going south, and here we go, the same thing. They take us wherever they feel like it. They took us, I don't even know where it was, but we stopped at a place, and this friend of ours, that physician, spoke beautifully Russian. He was very well-educated man who was under the Russian occupation during the First World War, so he was actually almost a Russian. And he found out that if we remain on the train we're going with, the next stop, they're going to put us on barges and take us someplace that is accessible only by water. So this was no good. We knew already that's no good. So we got out of the train and remained on the station, in the station, did not go with the rest of the people, and got on another train and went to Fergana, was a town. We stayed there maybe 5 days when the Russians decided this was not a good idea to let the people free. We're going to get them back all together and send them into one specific place. Back we went into the cattle cars, and we traveled for 2 days when somebody decided, no, forget about the whole idea, get them back where they were. So, but knowing the Russians, they were not very well organized. So what they did, they left, you know, they would accumulate cars, 2 cars from here, 2 cars from there, 3 cars from there, make a big train. On the way back, they didn't bother to know where they took you from. They knew from this spot they took 3 cattle cars, so they left 3 cattle cars behind. And we did not end up where we started from. So here we are, standing in the middle of nowhere. All of a sudden, we're not going wherever they wanted to take us. I think it was Barabijan or someplace. That was the rumor, because nobody tells you anything. And again, we are nowhere. So that friend of ours, the Dr. Klumkin, gets quickly acquainted with one person there, with a woman in the post office. And she's the only one who can get out anything out of the place. And he tells her that we don't want to get out of here. And he sends a telegram to Stalin that we are city people. We have a lot of professional doctors, engineers, pharmacists. And they want to put us here in nowhere, total wilderness, and we don't belong here. And we're waiting for an answer, and we sit 3 days in a car, 3 cars of us, we sit 3 days in it, and they try to tell us to get out, unload, get off, get out, and Kavuda standing there, and nobody is budging. We just don't go. So on the third day, they started actually physically taking out our possession out of the cattle cars and putting them outside. All of a sudden, everything stops. We quickly find out that the telegram came back from Stalin's office, sent them to a city. And we get back into the car ourselves. We put the things back, and they pulled the 3 cars to a much to a town already by the name of Kokanda. And that's where we go in a kolkhoz, which is a farm.
Where was this
Kokanda? It's also south, it's very close to Uzbekistan. And we go to a kolkhoz, which is a collective farm, but it's very close to town, within walking distance, to a small town, but a town, where there are schools already, where you can do something. He's becoming a physician right away. We're already back in business. And we stay there, and we're living a reasonably good life. There's an epidemic of typhoid, and my grandfather dies there. And lucky nobody gets it, although we were all sleeping on one wooden plank in one room. Our entire family was just a wooden plank and some straw on it, and that's how we were sleeping. He got typhoid, and nobody caught it. And he passed away there in Kokanda. And we thought we were going probably to stay there till the end of the war, but this was not to be, because they started again. We had to take Russian passports. And my father said, no, we're not taking any Russian passports. So they arrested, we, the women took. My mother took, my grandmother took, my grandfather was dead already, and we were kids yet, so it didn't pertain to us. But my brother, my father, and the Dr. Klumkin, that friend of ours, that refused to take the Russian passports. They arrested them and put them in jail. My brother remained in jail for 2 years almost, for no other reason but not wanting to accept a Russian passport. My father and Dr. Klumkin convinced these idiots. They showed them passports. My father, as I told before, had a passport, a Polish passport, consular passport, and Dr. Klumkin had a driver's license with his picture on them. They convinced them that they are important people, and they let them go. And From then on, we found out my father had cousin in Leninabad, which was Uzbekistan. And over there, for money, they were selling what was called bezgrashtansky passport in no man country or whatever it is, non-citizenship. So when they got out of jail, my father and Dr. Klumkin, they went to Leninabad, got themselves the passports, bought the passports. So they were not Russian citizens, and we followed them. And over there, we started a normal life.
How did you travel there?
By train.
But already free?
More or less. There was a short distance. We got what was called przepustka. Przepustka was a permit that permitted you to go from one spot to another. That's it. From Kokanda to Leninabad. And for money, you got przepustka. It was no problem. So all of us went to Leninabad. As I said, we had already the Russian passports, didn't bother us. My father got his bezgrashtansky passport, and my brother was sitting in jail because of that.
Where? In Kokanda?
In Kokanda, right there in jail. So we came to Leninabad. My father went into business, with the approval of the government. They took a big share. They were baking cookies. They were making beer. And they were making syrups and selling sodas. I have a picture here standing in a stand selling soda.
About what time was that?
This was 1943. And I went there back to school. They had a Polish school, was a large population. I went to high school, have a picture of it, and I graduated the high school, the Polish high school in Leninabad. And we led more or less normal life. I mean, I have happy to say that with all the hardship, I was dating and doing all kind of things and had a little parties, nothing to it, but you know, youth is youth. They can't take it away. And nobody was there. We were never in fear of being killed or things like this. That was not the case. Never.
What was the population of Leninabad?
I don't know.
The population was Russian?
Russian. Uzbekis. Uzbeki. Yeah.
And
they
how
were Muslims.
How many of you refugees were there?
Oh, there were quite a few thousand, probably. Several thousand. We had school, so it was enough to sustain a school. And it was a larger...
So the school was not a Russian school?
No, it was a Polish school. Polska Srednia Szkoła, Polish middle school. Polish school with the Polish teachers, with the Polish principal, and they taught us just in Polish, and they taught English also, but they had all subjects. And an engineer, a good friend of ours, who was teaching physics, you know, and chemistry. So that was a regular school. It was a university there, too.
And where did you live? What were the accommodations?
We had a little house. We had a little house. Two rooms or three rooms, two rooms and a kitchen. Yeah.
That were rented? These were rented or these were?
It wasn't ours, so I assume it was rented. I couldn't tell you how it worked. I don't know.
But you don't know if you were paying rent or was this provided?
No, we were paying rent. No. That was not, this was quote, free people. We were on our own. I could go wherever I wanted. It was a town. I could go to school. I didn't have to. I could work. I didn't have to. It was not, it was nothing. So this was probably rented. As I said, my father worked in that company, and we opened ourselves a few stands and selling sodas. That made money, you know? Mm-hmm. Good money.
What about your mother? Your mother?
My mother never worked, no. She stayed home with my grandmother. Maybe she helped in the little kiosk, whatever. I don't recall. Probably she helped there when I was in school.
How long did you stay in Leninabad?
We stayed there until 1946. In May of 1946, the war was over in April, but in May of 45, but we stayed there. There was no way of us getting out. In May 46, they did us a great favor. They put us back into cattle cars and sent us back to Poland.
Why?
Because the war was over and they had enough of us, I guess. If you wanted, some people remained. Believe it or not, some people stayed behind. But I don't know anybody.
But you already had Russian passport.
Yes, but that's what it proved, that only something that Russian can do. The people with Russian passports were free to go. The one, like my father and that friend, Klumkin, who had bezgrazhdensky, it means no man, no country, they could not go. Neither could my brother, who was since then out of prison and also had one of the passports.
When was your brother freed from the prison?
In 1945, I think, after the war was over, he was freed. He was in jail. His charges were that he is a homeless person. That's what his charges against him. So he could not go, and my father couldn't go, and Klumkin couldn't go. All the people, other people could go. So my brother married my sister-in-law at that time, just to marry her, because she had a citizenship. And my father had no choice, but was left behind with my sister, who was too young to have her own papers. So they stayed behind, my mother, my father, my grandmother, and my brother. We went to Poland. And they, a few days later, they got the permission to leave, my father, and they went on their own, and they went already in luxury because they went in passenger train through Moscow to Poland. We waited for them. We came to Poland. We went to Krakow directly. In Krakow, we met my uncle, my mother's brother-in-law, whose wife was already killed. She was dead. She was killed by the Nazis. We met him and both of his sons, and we stayed a few days with them until my father came. We tried to get to our apartment just to see. We were not let past the front door of the building. They told us we have nothing to look for. The Germans took everything out. There is nothing there that belongs to us, and the people don't want to be bothered.
Who told you that?
The superintendent of the house. That was it. We walked around town. I went to take a look to the school I went to. There was a monastery in it, and it was very, very depressing. The town was not the same. There was nobody we knew. The Jews were all gone. And as soon as my father came from Moscow with my sister, we left town and we went to Wrocław.
Did you know what happened to the other Jews?
We already knew.
Left behind?
Yes. This, by that time, we knew everything. My father was a man, as I said, who traveled an awful lot and who knew Germany in and out, and never believed all through the war with all the stories that were written in the Russian papers. He was always calling it the Russian propaganda. He was saying Germans, a cultural country like that, with cultural people like that, could never think even of doing the atrocities that the Russians are telling us that they're doing. But when we came back, we knew that that was not Russian propaganda. Nobody could describe in words what really, really happened. So we knew that. So that was it.
So that means that there was news in the Russian newspapers at
yes.
the time when you were
yes.
in Russia
yes.
about what's happened?
Yes. Yes. Not in exact forms, but all the camps and killings. But the Russians were doing the same, so you really did not know what is propaganda and what is not propaganda. It was very difficult. But we knew when we came to Poland and we left Krakow and we went to Wrocław, because a mayor of Wrocław, the city that was Breslau before the war, was a very good friend of my parents. It was Dr. Wach, who was voivoda before the war. That was one of the non-Jews that my parents were very friendly with. And he became the mayor of Wrocław because he was anti-Nazi. And most of the people who knew him went to Wrocław. Wrocław, we had it very good because we were given a complete, beautiful apartment with everything in it that they took away from the Germans. My father quickly bought himself a business, 1-2-3. He bought a grocery store, like a dairy store. And I enrolled at the University of Wrocław quickly. My brother enrolled. And then my father went back to Nowy Sącz to see what's happening there.
We have to stop for changing of the tape.
Okay.
Edith Milman. Now you were in Wrocław, your father got a business. What kind of business?
He bought a store which dairy products. And we were doing fine. And he went to Nowy Sącz to see what's going on there, to find anything, anybody, whatever. He found nothing, a couple pictures, found out that everybody was gone. And was returning back to Wrocław through Krakow. At that time, there was a different route because the Russians had taken over railroads, so he had to go through Chabówka to Krakow. And in Chabówka, he decided he's going to visit his friend in Zakopane, the one I mentioned once before. And that's where he went to visit him for a day. While he was in Zakopane, accidentally, pure accident, the train between Chabówka and Krakow was stopped someplace in between. Polish Armia Krajowa, which was the top anti-Semites of the world, stopped the train and pulled out seven Jewish men from that train and killed them. And my father, not knowing anything about it, and we not knowing that he went to Zakopane, were sure that he is one of the seven because he was supposed to be on that train. So when he finally arrived, luckily for us, safe and sound, by will of God, home, he came back to Wrocław, and we said, this is it. We are leaving this country forever and ever and ever. Enough is enough. And at that time, the Haganah was working of trying to get the Jews out of Poland.
Now, what date was that?
This is August or September, maybe September of 1946. He made some kind of a connection arrangements. I don't know, I don't recall it, but we came to a border of Poland and Czechoslovakia, and I don't know where. And in the middle of the night, our family plus a small group of other people, some of our, a couple we met there, we're very friendly still with, were taken over the border of Czechoslovakia to Austria, walking.
Who was taking you?
They were leaders. They were from Haganah. And they told us a story that we are now Greek Jews. They're Greek. And we don't have, we could not have a piece of paper that told us who we were. And the pictures that we carried with us all the time, we had to cross off every writing that was in Polish because we were Greek. And we were not allowed to talk. And they took us over. And we ended up, the next thing I remember, and I don't recall the trip, was in Austria, was in a camp. That was not called a DP camp, it was like transport camps. They held us there for a very short time, and this was in Kleinmünchen, outside of Linz in Austria. And from there, they shipped us to Germany. All their idea was to take us out of Poland. The whole thing was at that time, they used to serve nothing else but courier, taking people outside of Poland into Germany or Austria. And we came to Austria, we came to Germany for a very short time to Bad Reichenhall. I don't know how we got there, I have no idea. And there was no opening in DP camp. And my future sister-in-law, who was very much interested in marrying my brother for real, not only on paper, had a very good friend in Bamberg in a DP camp. He was the chairman of the DP camp in Bamberg, and that camp was also closed, but they made room for us. So we all arrived, my parents, my sister, my brother, and my grandmother arrived in Bamberg, which was in Bavaria, and came to this DP camp in Bamberg. I started working for a short while in a food supply store in the camp. I don't know why, whatever. And very short after, my parents didn't like that kind of living.
What kind of living?
It was like barracks type of living. You know, it was, I think it was former army barracks. So my father rented a place, a very nice apartment in the city of Bamberg, and moved out. That's it. We were free. I mean, that here we are really free. So if you had the resources and you knew what you were doing, we ended up living in the city of Frankfurt, of Bamberg. My brother got married there in 1947 to my sister-in-law, Rachel Garfinkel. And
in Bamberg?
In Bamberg.
Who performed the ceremony?
A rabbi. We had a Hungarian rabbi. It was a religious ceremony. And I went to Frankfurt. I wanted to go study, and I went to Frankfurt, and I enrolled in the University of Frankfurt. And originally I wanted to study medicine all the time, but that was not practical because it would take too long, and we were waiting for visas to United States. My father had a brother in the United States who was sending us visas all through the war, including one to Poland and one to Russia. That didn't come to being, and into Germany also. But so I went to the University of Frankfurt.
Did you know German?
No, I did not know German at all. I enrolled in Russian courses, taking Russian language, a course that taught Russian. And I was learning German in reverse. Since I knew Russian, I was learning German from that.
Were there any other refugee students in the university?
Yes, quite a few of them. Quite a few. My aunt's brother was a president of the Jewish Student Council, and they had a great influence. They could get the kids in ahead of all the Germans, and that's how I had an opportunity to go to school without having to pay. And I enrolled in the University of Frankfurt in the School of Medical Technologists.
Did you study together with German students?
all were German students. In our class, there were two girls only who were survivors. Two girls who survived camps were in my class. It was all females. So, and the rest were all German. And we studied at a regular university.
And the teachers?
All Germans. All Germans. And I lived, I had rented a room with a German family. I had one room, and I supported myself very easily with the packages we got from Joint Distribution Committee, or UNRWA. For students, they would give us an extra package that consisted of a carton of cigarettes and a pound of coffee. And I did not smoke, so one pack of cigarettes paid for my rent. One pack, not a carton, a pack. So the rest was all free, so it's no problem, really. As I said, we led a normal life, dating and going out with boys and fooling around with girls and doing all the things.
And that
so I was lucky.
When?
This was in 1947.
That was early 1947.
And I graduated in beginning of 49, and I moved back to Bamberg, and I went to work in a German hospital in Bamberg until our departure.
Was your family still staying in
Bamberg?
My
family was in Bamberg, yes. My whole family was in Bamberg. And from Bamberg in 1949, in August, or in July, we went to Bremerhaven. We got our visas based on the papers that my uncle has been sending, but on the DPIC photo. And I went with my parents and my grandmother to Bremerhaven. My sister went by herself ahead of us because she got the papers together with my parents, but there were no papers for my grandmothers. So my parents were allowed to wait for my grandmother, but my sister was not. So she went alone, all by herself, to United States, then followed by my parents, my grandmother, and myself. We went together. Although I had separate papers on my own already, I was a grown person. And my brother and his wife came later. She was the Austrian citizen, which had all the preferences. He was the last one to come. And the funny part, all three of us going separately arrived on the same boat, on General Hahn. All three families, and that was my brother was the last trip that General Hahn took to United States.
Oh, so these were three different trips on the same ship?
Right, for us. Three different trips, three different times.
Where did you arrive?
I arrived in Boston. And from Boston, by train, we came to New York. My uncle was not in the country at that particular time, so they put us up in a hotel. And as soon as he came, he had an apartment ready for us. He was waiting for us. He was a bachelor, and he kept an eight-room apartment in New York City for us. My sister was living there already, so as soon as he came back, they released us to him, and we lived on a very nice apartment in New York City on 99th Street and Western Avenue. I started going to work quickly. I was so anxious to work. I did not know why. I started working for free in Beth Israel Hospital because there was a German doctor who was doing everybody a favor by taking them in and let them work for free. This didn't last with me too long. I didn't like it. I didn't like him. I didn't like the whole situation. And I got myself a job on my own. I found a job and started working in 1949 at Maimonides Hospital in Brooklyn. Remained working in the hospital field until 1955. Most of them in Maimonides later switched from General Laboratory to David Dresdale, who was a cardiologist who was doing very progressive work. He was doing heart catheterization, one of the very first in the country. And I worked with him until 1955 when I had my first child. I quit working.
When did you marry?
I married in October 11, 1953. And my daughter Helene was born on July 23rd, 1955. We lived then in East Orange already. And shortly after, we moved to Flemington, New Jersey, where my parents had a farm. My father not ever working for anybody unless it was forced labor, decided he's going to go on his own no matter what it is, and he became a gentleman farmer. That means he bought a farm, chicken farm. He never worked on it. Either had somebody or two son-in-laws who did the work, but not him. He didn't believe in hard work. And we moved to Flemington, New Jersey, because my husband was a manager of a union local, ILGWU, and he was transferred to Plainfield, which was maybe 25 miles from Flemington, so I wanted to be close to the family. We bought a house and a little farm also in Flemington to supplement his income, which was very small, by raising some chickens and selling some eggs. And I worked for a short time, part-time, doing research work in Flemington in Huntington Medical Center, and then stopped, had another daughter we had in 1958. Unfortunately, I had a lot of illnesses in between, consequences of the war. I recovered, and he was working and I was not working, doing part-time little jobs at the hospital and in doctor's offices until 19.
You were by that time a certified technician?
Medical technologist when I graduated Germany.
Did you have to go through any exams here in the United States?
No, none. They recognized it fully, none. I got a job from the very first day. None. And then in 1972, when my girls were ready for school and his income could not pay for schools we wanted to send them to, by pure coincidence, we went into business totally unknown to us. We bought a small motel right in town. Worked on it very, very hard for 12 years. Out of nothing, we built a beautiful place of 104 rooms. 20 nothing. It's a restaurant, conference rooms and all that. And we're very fortunate in selling it at a very good price in 86, December, and retired to enjoy the good life America, only America can offer. And that's where we are. Enjoying our winters in Florida and our summers back north, enjoying the kids, the grandchildren.
How many grandchildren do you have?
We have two grandchildren. Seth, who will be 7, and Stephanie, who was just 3. They are son and daughter of my younger daughter, Marion, who married Levine, Jeff Levine, in 1989, June 11th, June 10th, I think. I don't know, don't remember. 1989, and Helene Milman, who married Patrick Willis in March 17th, 1993. They have no children. They live in San Diego.
And you're happy to be in America?
Very happy to be in America. As I said, I was brought up as Zionist, and I very much wanted to go to Israel during the, especially when they had, before the establishment of the State of Israel, they had the recruiting the college students. And I was ready to go, but my parents said, no way. After what we lived through and we are together, you're not going anywhere. And my father was coming to America all along because he had a brother here. His brother came, he lived in London. He had 3 brothers who lived in England, who fled from Germany to England after Hitler came. And one of them came to the world, World's Fair in 1939 from London and could never get back. So he remained in the United States. And so we actually came to him.
Is there anything that you would like to say to your family, to your children and grandchildren, or to the world in view of your experiences?
It's a very big thing to say to the world, you know. But one thing, I'm very grateful to Spielberg for contributing all the money he's doing, for taking my story, which is very small, but taking all the other stories that for centuries will reflect the real Jewish pre-war life that all of them had to contributed to by all the tapes, and that will remain for historical reason. That's very important. I'm very, very, very happy even to be a part of it. To my children, remember who you are.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It was a real pleasure. Thank
Ours
you.
Too.
Who is in this picture? This picture on standing from the left is my father, Joseph Birnbaum. Next to him is my mother's sister, Manya Manaster. Next to her is my mother's mother, Dora Frey, and her father, Rudolf Frey.
Her husband.
Her husband. Next to is my mother, Anna Birnbaum. And next to her is her my mother's brother, Bronek Frey. In front, on the left, it's myself, Edith Milman, Edith Birnbaum at that time, my brother, Alfred Birnbaum, and my cousin, Leah Manaster.
And when was this taken?
This was taken in Rabka, I think, in 1928.
Rabka, Poland.
Rabka, Poland. Thank you. It was a kurort.
Thank you. Who is in this picture?
In this picture is my father's sitting, my father's mother, Hinda Birnbaum, holding on her lap my sister, Ada Birnbaum, and standing next to them, it's myself, Edith Birnbaum.
When was
and
this
taken? Picture was taken in 1931 in front of someplace in front of our house in Nowy Sącz, Poland.
Thank you. Who is in this picture?
On this picture, standing from left to right, is my father, Joseph Birnbaum, my mother, Anna Birnbaum, her uncle and her aunt. Her name is Sala, but I don't remember their last name. In front of them is myself, Edith, and my sister, Ada. And this was taken in Zakopane, Poland, in 1935.
Thank you. Who is in this picture?
This picture behind the counter, I'm standing, I, Edith Birnbaum, supplementing our income by selling soft drinks. And this was in 1943 in Leninabad, Uzbekistan, USSR.
Thank you. Who do we see in this picture?
This is a picture of my school, my class picture. I am the third one from the right, and the school was the 10. Klasa Polskiej Średniej Szkoły Leningrad 1945, which is equivalent to the 12th grade of high school in the United States, and this was in Leninabad, Russia.
When?
USSR in 1945.
Thank you. Who is in this picture?
From left to right is my brother Alfred Birnbaum and his wife Rachel, my brother-in-law Sal Urbach, and my sister Ada Urbach, Leah and myself, my grandmother Dora Frey, my father Joseph Birnbaum, my mother Anna Birnbaum, and my father's brother Charles
sperm bomb. It was taken in New York City on our wedding day, October 11, 1953.
Thank you.
Who is in this picture?
This picture from the left, it's myself, Edith Milman, our daughter, Marion Milman, my husband, Leon Milman, and my daughter, my older daughter, Helene Milman. And this is June 1989, one of the happiest day parents have by marrying off the child.
Where?
This was in New Jersey.
Thank you. Who are these two children?
These two children are my grandchildren, the children of my daughter Marion and her husband Jeffrey Levine. On the left is Seth Andrew, born February 13, 1991, and my granddaughter Stephanie.
And when was this taken?
This was taken in 1997 in Washington, D.C.